Megan said, this is a project that I've been working on for a very long time. I am going to just talk about a few aspects of that project, and it was in light of the theme this month, which is compassion. And I've never done a talk about this project related to the theme compassion, so it gave me the chance to reflect about all of the ways that compassion has shown up for me and in this project. So I'm going to take you through a little bit of history, and I'm going to tell you a little bit about what we're doing now, and then I believe we're going to have a chance to do some Q&A afterwards, so if you have questions, great. The truth about this is that in some ways this project began because of a lack of compassion. At least that's the way I viewed myself. I used to see people on the street back in the early 90s, and like a lot of people, I ignored them. I pretended to fiddle with the radio. It was before cell phones, so I couldn't pretend to do that, but I found ways to ignore them. And for whatever reason, the idea to start buying their signs occurred to me. And in 1993, I bought my first sign. I don't remember which sign that was. This is a sign that I've probably had for 18 years or so, and this is one that to me sums up this project in a lot of ways. And you know, in thinking about compassion, which I think has to do with empathy, this sign made me think about what it would be like to be on the street holding a sign. So I've been buying signs for a long time. I've bought signs that are serious and authentic. I've bought signs that are humorous. I bought this in Austin, Texas from a guy who really wanted to talk for a long time. And, you know, the fact that this is also about creativity, which is what I teach at SMU and has been a part of my life pretty much as long as I can remember, I'm also fascinated by the signs themselves, the creativity in the signs, and how people go about trying to connect with people on the street. This is a sign that's over 20 years old. It's currently mounted to a mirror at my house, which gives me a chance every time I walk by it to see myself behind that sign. These signs have become this part of this big project, and it wasn't until I was in grad school that I did my first ever art show. And in fact, she mentioned the stew pot. Where are you? So at this opening in 2009, this was the first art show I ever did utilizing these signs. I hired an artist at the stew pot, one of their clients, who agreed to hold a homeless sign at the opening and drink wine along with all the guests. A lot of my friends had never spoken to a person on the street before, and it was fascinating for me to get to watch them connecting with Clyde, was his name. And the project continued. In the early days, I was trying various things, trying to figure out this project. I would combine digitally pieces from various signs, created a series around that, but it wasn't long before I realized the signs contained all of the compassion that they needed. I didn't have to do anything. So part of the things that I was doing while I was in grad school, one of them was going around and photographing places where people slept. One of my classmates was doing a photo series, and walking up under an underpass and seeing these places and photographing them increased my empathy. So I could feel compassion growing in me as I was doing research. I also went to the stew pot and shot video and interviewed people there, bridge and other shelters. I gathered a bunch of my friends, and three different times we did what we would call the performance out at the close to Mockingbird and Central, and we would all stand there holding signs, and when people would pull over to find out why we were there, we'd hand out cards, directing them to our blog to find out more about the project. The third time we did this, I had the bright idea to put our URL on dollar bills and hand out money, which is illegal. And the police came and made us stop. You can't hand out money on the street. I didn't know this. I did, by the way, for several months, I had a detective on my speed dial who I would call every time we were doing an event because he would help us negotiate with the cops because they always showed up.
So this ultimately led to doing large-scale installations, which I've been doing now for the last 9 years or so. Some of them are on walls, in galleries, or other public spaces. I've done installations on, this is on the floor of an abandoned house. This is at a, was at a gallery recently in Dallas, just a couple of months ago. Then some hanging installations as well, where it depends on the space, but it's very, for me, interesting to create a space where people can walk among the signs as they are hanging. So this project, and this is what they look like, it's a very methodical process. Later today, I'm going to be getting on a plane and going to Grand Rapids, Michigan, where Art Prize is going to open next week, the largest public art event in the world. And I'm one of 1,400 artists that are going to be participating. So I'll be doing this in Michigan beginning tomorrow morning. So I'm going to go back now to 2012. I did my first talk about this project and it was during that time that I connected that in 1993 I bought my first sign, and in 1993 I'd written a letter to my dad because my dad and I did not have a super great relationship. I grew up terrified of him. He was physically abusive. Now this picture shows that we have since done some mending of the fences, and I'd like to report that things are a lot better. He's still an asshole sometimes, to be completely honest. But we have at least come to some terms. But it was in 1993 that I wrote this Come to Jesus letter to him about my upbringing. And it was at that point that I first asked myself this question, is there some part of me that felt homeless? And for me, it was around safety. Now, I always had food, I always had a place to sleep. But this question has become something that I have asked people to consider. Because part of being compassionate, if it's really about empathy, can some piece of you identify with people that are on the street? So I'd ask you to consider this. I'm going to ask you another question later, but is there a part of you that is homeless? Back to that same talk about my dad, that's the first time that I said, one of these days I want to travel across the country and buy signs. Now I said this kind of just one of those things that I just said, and I realized it's a TEDx talk, it's online, I probably ought to actually do it. And so a couple of years later, we began planning this trip, which began in Seattle, and it went down through San Diego, ended up in New York City. We planned it, we raised money through Indiegogo to take this trip, and we began what was, for me, one of the adventures of my lifetime. So I'm going to share just a few of the signs from that trip. This one came from a guy named Shadow in Seattle. This one was in San Francisco, Philadelphia, Chicago, Los Angeles. A couple of these signs, by the way, have been delivered in Grand Rapids, so they'll be installed in the show that's going to happen there. This was from a guy named Michael in Las Vegas. It's an amazing interview that happened on this trip. And I'm going to share some of the people that I met. And one of the huge advantages of taking this trip was that we got to interview people on the street, sometimes at length, and all for the purposes of putting together a documentary film about this project. So I met Owen, who was in Portland, and Owen was very creative. He said he got to Portland with 63 Sharpies. By the time we met him, he said he was down to his last three because he kept giving them away to his friends. He showed me another kind of compassion on the street because he was taking care of Polly. He and Polly hung out together. Polly had some sort of mental health issue, I'm not quite sure what, but I got to see how people on the street take care of each other. This was a man named Neil in San Francisco whose wife had just passed away, and after walking with him for 12 or 15 minutes, he pulled out his notebook and told me that he wrote music and wanted me to see this, and I don't know music enough to know if it was good or not, but I could tell that he had this passion. Chaz Kyle was in Denver. He and his buddy had hung out together, and they talked a lot about the fact that when they were together, they felt safe and at home. This was Danelle. I met her in Albuquerque. She and her son were on the street. She was 78 years old at the time, so that means that she's 80 now or more, 81 perhaps, but she had two cats, and there were no shelters in Albuquerque that allowed pets. And she was not going to give up her pets, which I realized was another thing that is really important to some of the people in the street. Michael was missing one of his legs. He was a veteran. I met him in Omaha. I could tell stories about all of these people, but another one of the things that Michael shared with me was that 12 people hung out together, he and mostly some Lakota Native Americans, and they all pooled all the money that they collected with each other. So they would buy food, they would feed each other. Again, compassion for each other, which I was continuing to learn. I'm going to play a little clip from Robert in Cincinnati.
My wife passed away of breast cancer. I had no insurance, couldn't keep the mortgage up, and it was just a matter of time. You know, you wake up one morning and you got the sheriff putting a tape on your door saying you have to leave today. I'm just so thankful my children are grown, because, you know, what would I do out here? If I had my three boys and they were still 8, 9, and 10 years old, what would I do? Yeah, I feel like there's no end. I mean, I know there is. Some days you feel hopeless, some days you don't. My philosophy on life is if you wake up, that should be the hardest part of your day, when you wake up. The rest of the day should be easy because the good Lord's given you another day to do whatever. But yeah, there's days you feel hopeless and trapped, but then there's days you feel hope and you think that maybe you're going to turn the corner. So.
That is the kind of conversations that we got to have. I got to hear a lot of different stories. Cheryl was in Detroit. To this day, she is the only person who has ever reached inside of the car to hug me after I bought her sign. She was full of juice and couldn't believe that I was going to give her money for her sign. So I want to show you this slide because Ellie is, at the time, was 17 years old. I met her in Baltimore. And the woman in the camo hat was taking care of Ellie. But Ellie was Romanian, she spoke 5 languages and was on the street with her family on and off. The reason that I want, 2 things about Ellie. One, she is now back in Romania, is pregnant and living with gypsies, which Michelle says is a good thing, even though they were hoping that she would be able to get the ability to stay in the United States, but wasn't. In meeting Ellie, I also met Patty, who hated having her picture taken, but Patty lives in Baltimore and spends every day of her life driving around handing out toys, clothes, condoms to underage girls that are homeless on the street, many of whom are living a truly painful existence. Patty is one of the people that I am in awe of and one of the people who I believe has just boundless compassion. So I got to meet her in this process, which continues to just help me learn about my own compassion. And this young man wanted to be a writer. He lived in New York City. He contacted me after I met him and told me that he was able to travel back to Pennsylvania. We communicated back and forth. He actually sent me several photos of himself, but I've since lost touch with him over the past 8 months or so. And I was hoping to connect with him the last time I was in New York. So those are some of the people. And the other part of this project that continues to feed me is the ripples. And some of them Megan shared. One that really convinced me of how almost everybody I know struggles with what to do when they see somebody on the street was the amount of media coverage we got traveling across the country. And since then, it was phenomenal. We got to Minneapolis and one of the stories got picked up by the Associated Press, and that of course caused every newspaper in the country to have a copy of this article. It led to us getting to do a segment on All Things Considered when we got to Washington, D.C. So on a personal note, that was like getting to visit the mothership, and I was just like, my God, super awesome. She mentioned the video on Upworthy that has been viewed over 6.4 million times. It's been shared almost 80,000 times. There are thousands of comments. I've only read a couple of hundred of these comments, but another way that I've learned about people's compassion for this issue is just through social media. Yes, there are always people who will say blanket statements about all homeless people are this or all homeless people are that, but the vast majority of the comments that I've read are not those kinds of comments. There are people that are connecting and telling me, in some cases, long stories about their own bout with homelessness or people that they know. So compassion is alive and well outside in the world, despite what you might hear on the news day in and day out. The other kinds of ripples, we finally finished our documentary and it's now been seen in 8 film festivals. We're currently talking to distributors and trying to figure out what its next life is going to be. But Signs of Humanity has given me the chance to also meet people in cities all around the country. Sometimes we will screen the film at other universities, but it's a chance to, again, let them see the humanity of the people that are on the street, and then I get to connect with people, some of which are doing amazing things for this issue all around the country, especially students. I have a very soft spot in my heart for young people who aren't jaded yet. So one of the things that I'm hoping is going to happen before we leave here is that you guys will hold a sign and that I will take a picture of you holding signs. But by far, for me, one of the most gratifying things is getting to share this story with people, because that is how I hear from other people about their own stories, their own solutions, their times where they felt awkward on the street or they've ignored people, because I've yet to meet somebody who has this figured out. I don't. The other kinds of compassion that I found out, so I spoke to a group of young Buddhists who were having a national conference here in Dallas, and when it was done, a young Asian man came up to me and told me he'd never shared that he had spent much of his childhood homeless living in a car. I got to speak to the downtown patrol, the folks that deal with homeless people every single day in downtown Dallas. I was totally ready to meet a bunch of calloused people. And instead, these guys, in lots of cases, are taking care. They have sort of taken one or two homeless people under their wings. They take care of them. They check on them if they're missing. So it also just completely changed my view. And I can talk about some of the SMU groups. There's students there that are doing amazing things to address this issue. So, again, compassion for me is just becoming interwoven with this project. I got to speak to J.L. Long Middle School in Dallas. The teacher there, who was a rock star, got her students to come up with ideas to help me with my project. The winning idea was they were going to make a video about this project to send to Ellen DeGeneres, which I'm like, hell yes. So, when they started shooting footage, we went back with our documentary crew and actually shot footage of them making their movies. And these are middle schoolers, and they were just on fire, on camera, coming up with these amazing stories. They still haven't edited their video yet. So I'm gonna finish up telling you about one guy in particular whose name is Eddie. And I met Eddie in Philadelphia, and he was carrying this sign. What if God occasionally visits Earth disguised as a homeless guy panhandling to see how charitable we are? Completely hypothetical, of course. Now, I could tell just from this sign that I liked Eddie. He looked kind of beat up, and I'm gonna show you a little clip of me interviewing him.
So tell me a little bit about what was behind your sign.
I had a more generic sign prior to that, and I wanted to go in a different direction, like be a little innovative. So, I mean, you know.
But how did you get the idea? I mean, where'd that come to you around?
I actually, it actually came to me, like, believe it or not, out of anger initially, because someone had said something derogatory towards me when I had asked them for money, and I came up with it in my head. I didn't think of it. I mean, I didn't say it to them, but I said, like, you know, for all you know, I'm God, like, just, you know, checking to see if you know how charitable people are, and if that's the case, you people are screwed, you know.
So Eddie is in our documentary, and a little while after that, I was doing a different talk, and you can see Eddie's sign is behind me. This was the cover photo on my Facebook page, and I get a Facebook message from some random guy named Eddie Dunn. He said, "Hey man, you probably don't remember me, but you bought my sign in Philly back in 2014, and that's my sign, and I just want you to know that I was on heroin when you bought this sign for me. I've been sober for a year and a half, and that I really like your project, and I just wanted you to know that." So I, of course, wrote back and told Eddie that I was about ready to go to Philadelphia. I was doing an installation at the Democratic National Convention. I said, "Dude, how about we have lunch?" And so this was part of a big group show in Philly, but I did this installation. You can see Eddie's sign mounted right there. And I picked Eddie up at the train station, and he got to come and see his sign on the wall. He stood in front of that and started crying. He's put on about 40 pounds, which he likes to talk about, since his heroin days. But Eddie is amazing. So we became friends. He's a big fan of the Wu-Tang Clan. He almost always has his Philly Flyer hat. So I did another exhibit at the University of Pennsylvania. I asked them if Eddie could join us on the panel for the Q&A, and he did. So Eddie and I's friendship continued until this past November, after he told me about his new grandkid, by the way. Eddie is like the proudest grandfather you will ever see. I asked SMU if they would fly Eddie up here so he could join me on stage to talk about this project, and they agreed. And I updated people about the project, and then I called Eddie on stage, and he got to talk about it from his perspective. He was able to humanize this in a way I can't do. He talked about what it was like to be ignored on the street, to have kids throw money at him, to have people yell obscene things. But again, he was able to deliver a message about compassion that, for me, was something I can't do. So I'm very grateful to Eddie. September 28th, coming up, we are doing a screening at the Arlington Music Hall in Arlington. It's a free screening, and they are flying Eddie to join us for the Q&A there as well. So we'll be sharing all of that in social media, but just want you to know I get to see Eddie again in a couple of weeks. So the second question I want to ask you is one that I asked everybody across when I was traveling across the country, and that is, what is home? So as you think about that, I want to share a tiny snip from our documentary where you will hear some of the answers that I got to hear on this trip.
Is a place, when I get done with work, I have a place to go sit down, relax, have my own quiet time, whatever, be able to fix my own food. I can pay my own bills. That's home to me.
Home is like if you wrapped yourself in a nice warm comforter when it was cold outside. That's all.
I feel safe, where I feel comfortable. They could be anywhere. It doesn't really matter.
And what does home mean to you?
Home means heaven.
Having a place over my head. Over my head.
A place that's dry and warm. Whatever you make it.
The one word that I would use for home is probably safety.
Home for me would be some place I go to every day, sleep, take a shower, that I wouldn't have to worry about finding a place to sleep every night.
Home is wherever I'm with the ones I love and the ones love me. It really doesn't care like where that is.
Is safety.
number one, it's comfort, and it's kind of like what you know.
Wherever I lay down at night, that would be home to me.
It doesn't have to be a physical place. It can be the people you're with or the experience you're having, but describing it's pretty hard.
Home means security to me. Because a large portion of the world, of the United States, will never know what it's like to not have a roof over your head. And I think a lot of people take advantage of that. To not know where you're gonna lay down is like the most frightening thing in the world.
What does home mean to you?
Sanctuary, place of rest.
See, now I haven't had a home since my wife died. See, when me and her were together, she made it a home. Love and family, that's what a home is to me.
But home to me was where mom was there, you know, eating dinner, you know. But as of right now, home is Clinton Bridge. That's where I sleep, underneath Clinton Bridge.
To me, a home is I can put a key in a door, open and go inside and relax, take a shower, watch TV, and sleep in a bed. You know, that's home to me.
Home to me would be one day somewhere I can call my own. That's what home would mean to me. Right now, home is wherever I can sleep.
Home to me is like pretty much where my friends are at, where my family's at, like, because like, we don't have a sense of home, so. Home is our family, like where we are together. When I lay my head next to him at night, that's home to me.
Home for me is that feeling of, I don't know how to say this in English, but it's literally like feeling physically and spiritually. It's feeling love, happiness, and calmness all at the same time. Like they cannot leave without each other.
That brings me to my last point I want to make about compassion. And it's something I didn't think about really until recently, but I want you all to think about this because my deep belief is that a lot of people struggle with this. A lot of people feel helpless around the issue of homelessness. And what I really believe is that compassion for yourself is where this starts. Go easy on yourself, whatever you believe about how much or how little you do related to homelessness. Go easy on yourself. It is only by being kind to yourself that you are going to be able to find that piece of you that's going to be able to be more generous, more accepting, even knowing that you may or may not be able to make a big difference. If you've taken any pictures of signs, I would love it if you would hashtag We Are All Homeless. It's how I keep track of people that I get to meet along this journey. Thank you. I'm honored to have been here. And keep being yourselves, keep being creative.